began in the mind and heart of God is nearly completed. The perfect Son of God has done everything that had to be done to be our sacrifice. The one who could have been called the legions of heaven to fight for him, who could have left the cross at any moment, who could have saved himself, hangs there until the work is accomplished. And with one final cry, he declares victory. wife and three daughters. We're just so happy to have them with us. We're going to ask Garrett to come this morning and share with us what the Lord has from His Word.
I'll get him. Tell him to wait for me. Wait for me. Tell him to wait. I'm going to take it.
Good morning.
Deacon Lee mentioned in worship we're going to have a whole family with us today. We were out of town earlier this week. Just a little trip out to Ohio. And while we were there, we went to Columbus Zoo and all those things out there. About Lexi inspected a really high fever. So we ended up in the emergency room in downtown Columbus. But thankfully, after some issues with having her insurance, we have come out of state, running through all that. Issues there. She's back to normal for a few days, so thankfully, I'm glad that all is going to be here with me today. I've got a handout here. I'm going to start out here with Brother Terry. Appreciate it. We are obviously going to talk about Easter Sunday. We are going to talk about Easter today and Jesus Christ rising from the grave. But the title of this message, The Wonder of Easter. So what I'm hoping to do is to maybe use a few passages of scripture that we might know from memory, that we don't always think of being tied into the Easter message, and see how that can tie into it to help us kind of recapture what I'm going to call the wonder of Easter. The wonder of Easter. Now, obviously, Easter is a wonderful time of celebration for us as Christians. However, often, if we're not careful, we can lose sight of the real importance, or I'm going to call the real wonder of Easter. We need to be careful not to allow Easter become just another tradition, where we get dressed up, go to church, or have a meal with our family, where we hide eggs for our kids or our grandkids to find. There's nothing wrong with any of these things. But we have to be really careful to make sure that they don't take away our attention from what Easter really is. And what it is really the most important day in history, the day that Jesus Christ Himself rose from the grave. So let's open with a word of prayer and we will get into the message. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for who you are. Not just for what you've done for us, but who you are. We thank you that we know that you are who you claim to be. We thank you that when we pray you, we come here to worship you, that we worship a living God who hears our prayers, who hears our praise, and can be affected by us, and wants to have a personal relationship with us. We thank you for all that you've done for us, all that you are to us. And you help us become more like you from our time in your word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now some of the statistics that I came across when I was preparing for this message, just some statistics on Easter. The total annual spending on all Easter-related goods in America, is $14.6 billion, with a B, $14.6 billion. The total annual spending on Easter candy is $2.1 billion. The average annual amount spent online only on Easter candy, clothes, and supplies per family averages to be around $225.43. The average amount that a family spends on a brick and mortar or a traditional store where you actually walk in on Easter goods is $131.04. The average family spent on Easter clothes this year was $60.55. The average amount spent on Easter candy was $28.11. I'm pretty sure all that ended up in our kids' baskets this morning. The average amount spent on Easter food, like the meal preparation for families, for Easter for brunch or Easter meal, $61.74. The average amount spent on Easter flowers for decoration in your house is $31.66. Easter gifts for other family members, $46.70. Decorations, door hanging, table settings, $28.11. Greeting cards to send to family, $17.20. And miscellaneous category of other, of $40.82. So we see here that even here in America, even us amongst Christians, Easter can become a very commercialized tradition. It can be something where the focus can be on so many other things than really where it should be, which is the celebration of Jesus Christ rising from the grave. This year in America, there were 120 million pounds of Easter candy that were purchased. There are 16 billion jelly beans that were made specifically for this holiday of Easter. The percentage of Easter candy that is purchased that is chocolate is 70%. And the number of chocolate bunnies made for Easter this year was 90 million. So 90 million chocolate bunnies. And the percentage of that, I just thought this was kind of not really relevant, but I thought it was kind of interesting. The percentage of Americans who say when you eat chocolate bunnies, you should eat the ears first, is 76%. So I don't know where they found these people, but apparently people have an opinion of it. Now getting into some of the more serious statistics here. In America, where as America, we are considered by the outside world as being what we would call a Christian nation. We are founded on Christian principles. Of all adults in America, when they ask about Easter, is it being either a religious holiday? 67% of Americans consider Easter to be a religious holiday. In America, only 42% of the population poll consider Easter to actually be related to not just a random religious holiday, but actually be Jesus' resurrection. So in our nation, a Christian nation as a whole, less than half, 40%, about two-fifths of our population, really recognize Easter for what it really is, the day of Jesus' resurrection. So when we are faced with statistics like these, it's important to stop and ask the question, so why is Easter so important to Christians? Today's Easter celebration marks the end of what is known as Holy Week, in which we Christians commemorate the crucifixion, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And according to the Gospel accounts, he was bodily raised from the dead on the third day. And sometimes when things become too familiar or too routine, they can start to lose where they start to lose their wonder. We're going to look at the Easter story today, the story of Jesus' resurrection, and hopefully a way that will reignite some of the truths about what truly make Easter so wonderful, regardless of if you eat your chocolate bunnies ears first or not. So we're going to start in the first outline is, I'm going to put it there in the blank. Is it Timmy not have the outline? Who has some extras if anybody needs one? He had to come down. If you'll turn your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 11. There's a very famous passage of scripture talking about the Tower of Babel. You might be wondering, what does the Tower of Babel have to do with the message on the resurrection? We're going to try to tie it in here to answer that question. Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 9 says, "And the whole world was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, Go to, let us make brick, and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime they had for mortar. And they said, Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. Let us make us a name, thus we be scattered abroad upon the face of the world. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children had built. And the Lord said, Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound the language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore, it's named to call Babel, because the Lord did there, confound the language of all the earth, And from thence did the Lord scan them abroad upon the face of all the earth. So we're going to focus here on a couple of key phrases. Now, oftentimes we think of the Tower of Babel. We tend to think about, at least I do personally, about God confounding our language. The people here at this time all spoke one language. They were able to communicate effectively with each other. And God came down because of the imaginations in their hearts, where they were trying to build a city or a tower to went all the way up to God. It's almost like God, man's rebellion against God. They decided they were going to take it upon themselves to get to heaven on their own, without needing to go through God. And we see Jesus, or God, confounding the language and ending up to disperse or scatter them throughout the populations of the world. But the phrase I want to focus on, if you look there in verse number 5, it says, and the Lord came down. And if you look over to verse 7, it says, and let us go down. Now, if you'll there, look at me over in, look back in verse number 3. And they said unto the Lord, go to let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and slime in for mortar. Now you have to understand, at this time in history, this was so far advanced technologically, giving the resources they had to come up with this process of using brick and mortar to build. This is the first time we see in a civilization where we see the human ingenuity of intellect and technology and ability to work together to get a common goal achieved. But regardless of all these things, we still see in verse number 5, it says that the Lord came down. Keep that in mind. In ancient times, I came across this in the study of the Tower of Babel. In ancient times, people thought that the heavens were not really all that far above the earth. They thought if they could only build a tower to the sky, they could climb up and be like gods themselves. Mankind had once again lost sight of God and become arrogant and self-sufficient. We may be tempted as humans to think that we no longer need to trust and obey God. We may believe that our learning, our sophistication, or our technology are all we need to be self-sufficient and to guarantee our own security. The lesson of the Tower of Babel is that such self-sufficiency is a delusion. There is nothing that any one of us can do ourselves to get to heaven. Regardless of our intellect, our personality, our good works, God still had to come down to make a way for us to get to heaven. We see here, these were the most sophisticated people on the earth. The best, the brightest, the smartest, and the best technology. But even the best of us, the walk the earth, there's nothing that we can do in our own might, in our own power, to get to heaven on our own. John chapter 6:38 says, for I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. John 6:51 says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. So the point number one is that he had to come down. He had to come down. The only way that any of us could ever have a hope of an eternal home in heaven was Jesus Christ himself had to come down to earth for us. We couldn't get to heaven on our own. Number two is he couldn't come down. He couldn't come down. So we see point one, he had to come down. Number two, we have he couldn't come down. If you'll turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 3. Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 3 says, you know the story here about Nehemiah feels led the Lord to go repair the gates in Jerusalem. Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 3 says, and I sent messengers unto them saying, that's Nehemiah called me, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the world cease whilst I leave it and come down to you? So I cannot come down. Matthew 27, verse 40 says, actually, I'll read 40, Matthew chapter 7, verses 40 to 50. It's saying, thou that destroyest the temple, and these are the people that were reviving Jesus when he's hanging on the cross. It's saying, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise, also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes of the elders said, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God. The thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same as thieves. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, this man called for Elias. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him a drink. The rest said, let be, let us see that Elias will come save me. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up and goes. So there in Matthew chapter 7, verse that passage we just read, verses 40 through 50, we see that the people that were reviling him were basically saying, if you are really the Son of God, if you are who you say you are, come down from the cross. If you save yourself, then we'll know that you're really God's Son, and then we'll trust in you to save us. But I think of this, it ties in beautifully with the song that I was saying earlier, with the special music. When he was on that cross, I was on his mind. Sometimes I wonder if while he's on that, when he was on that cross, if he was thinking, just like we read about in Nehemiah, the work is too great. His purpose on that cross was too important that he could not come down. If he had gotten off that cross, which he had the ability, he had the power to come out off that cross. But if he did, none of us would ever have the hope of getting saved and spending eternity in heaven with the Lord himself. In chapter 27, verse 42, where it says, if he be the King of Israel, let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe it. My own human nature, full of pride and sin, if somebody challenges me to do something I know I can do, my natural inclination is to do it just to prove people wrong. If you tell me, don't, you can't do that, I tend to be pretty naturally competitive, so it's not always the best reason. Sometimes I'll do it just out of spite, just to social media I can do it. Thank God he wasn't like that. Could you imagine if Jesus actually gave it and did physically pull himself off the cross? He could have made a point to them, but where would we be? No hope. Thankfully, what we see here in verse number 2, the work was so great that he could not come down. Verse number 3, this is where we spend the majority of our message, the time for our message here on Easter Sunday, is they couldn't keep him down. You see, number one, he had to come down. Number two, he couldn't come down. Number three, they couldn't keep him down. If you'll turn, if you will follow along with these passages of scripture, because every kind of time we use your story, we may appreciate it. And they're there on your Mark chapter 16. Verses 46 and 47. And he bought fine linen, took him down, and wrapped him in the linen, and laid him in a sepulcher, which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled a stone into the door of the sepulcher. Okay, so we see that they're trying to keep him in the grave. They rolled a stone in and they're trying to keep him down. And Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of Joseph, beheld where he was laid. Okay, so there was witnesses here that actually saw what had taken place. They saw that Jesus was in the tomb and they rolled the stone in front of it to keep him from getting out of the grave. Matthew chapter 27. I'm sorry, it should be Mark 15. It's 15, yeah, 15. I'm sorry about that. I'm going to my notes.
Thank you.
I'm sorry about that. My apologies. It's hard to find verses that aren't there sometimes. Matthew chapter 27. Verses 62 through 66. These ones, I think these are the right ones. So. Matthew chapter 27, starting with verse 62, says, "Now the next day of the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, 'Sir, we remember that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure till the third day, lest his disciples come by night, steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first.' Pilate said unto him, 'You have a watch, go your way, and make it as sure as you can.' So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch." Now the part that I found was kind of interesting about this verse here, verse 66, where it says, "sealing the stone." When I came across that, it actually ties back into what we looked at first previously in the Tower of Babel. When they talk about sealing the stone, they would actually use that aforementioned brick and mortar to make the slime and actually seal the stone into place into the tomb. So it almost becomes cemented into place. So I thought that was kind of interesting that those verses kind of back each other up. So we see here the great lengths that they went through to keep him down, to keep him in the tomb, to keep him from rising from the grave. We're going to see now in John chapter 20, verses 1 through 9, how their efforts were not effective. John chapter 20, verse number 1, "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter, and to the other disciple, whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of our sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter, and came first to the sepulchre. And he stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went not in. Then comes Simon Peter following him, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lying, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple, which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise from the dead." So we see here, obviously, despite all their efforts to seal the tomb, to get the biggest, heaviest stone they could find, none of that was able to keep him down. Thankfully, Jesus Christ did what he said he came to do, did what he said he was going to, and rose from the tomb. Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 8. Chapter 24, verses 1 through 8 says this: "Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they gave it to the sepulchre, bringing spices which they had prepared and certain others with them." So you see here, when they came to the grave, they were bringing spices which were typically used to prepare the body for burial, dead bodies. They weren't coming there expecting to find a risen Savior. "And they found the stone roll away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid, and bowed up their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered to the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. I'm going to read a little passage here, as I was coming through this, trying to get some ideas about what is so wonderful about Easter. What, just the wonder of Easter. And I came across a Christian man who writes for a magazine. He gave basically a testimony about why Easter is wonderful to him. And I couldn't help but, as I was reading through it, I started thinking about people in my own life, where I could kind of plug myself into and relate to his story. So as you're listening to this, he's going to be talking about his friend. But as he's talking about his friend, I want you to try to think about people in your own lives that God speaks to you through, touching your heart in this way about. He says, When I was in high school, I had a friend named David. He was the kind of kid that everyone liked. He was cool and athletic. He was the star of the volleyball team. Everyone loved how crazy funny he was. And Dave loved God a lot. One day during our junior year, Dave didn't show up for astronomy class. I found out very quickly that Dave was seriously sick. Over the next months, I watched as he got worse. He couldn't walk and ended up in a wheelchair. Then he had trouble moving his head up or even speaking clearly. We found out that Dave had a brain tumor. There was nothing the doctors could do for him. Dave got worse and worse. Before the end of our senior year of high school, Dave died, and none of us could believe it had happened. I would like to see my friend again. I'd like to see the joy on Dave's face when he played volleyball. I'd like to see him whole, strong, athletic, and crazy funny. And I believe I will. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead so that my friend David may too. The resurrection of Jesus assures me that God has indeed conquered death. He physically walked out of the tomb with his real body. It's because Jesus' victory over death that we have hope in the life everlasting. But if there's no resurrection, there's no hope. And Christian belief is pretty lame. Does that sound a little harsh? Well, check out something the Apostle Paul said. I'll turn it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You're going right now, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 14 and 15. Verse 14 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 says, And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching in vain. And your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. So belief in the resurrection of Jesus is huge. Because of it, I will see my good friend David. He will be walking. He will be whole. He will not have a tumor in his brain. No, I don't know exactly what his resurrected body will look like or when, but I do know that our resurrected bodies won't grow old and will never die. I believe in the resurrection and the life everlasting because it's a very important fact in my faith, but it's also way more than just a fact. I believe in the resurrection and the life everlasting because I'm looking forward to meeting Jesus and spending an eternity talking to him, learning from him, and just being with him. I believe in the resurrection and life everlasting because I'll also get to spend a whole lot of time with my Christian friends and family members who have died. I believe in the resurrection and life everlasting because in heaven there will be no backstabbing, no gossip, no quicks. There will be no more sin, the very thing that brought sin and death into the world in the first place. I believe in the resurrection and life everlasting because I will live in a heavenly world full of real, honest, love, and compassion. And I believe in the resurrection and life everlasting because I will be able to see my friend and maybe challenge him to a game of volleyball. And he'll destroy me, but I won't care because it's Dave. Now, as I was reading this, did anybody have, I'm assuming, did anybody have people pop into your mind that that's kind of up there? This week especially was a tough one for me. I read this, just to be transparent, but now that I read this, my best friend died on April 10th, not 2004. So this past couple weeks were difficult for me. He died in a car accident at 21 years old. So when I think about this, the reason that his name was Phil, and I thank the Lord that I know that he's saved and I'll get a chance to see him again. But part of the reason that Easter, and Easter's always been very special to me. You know, growing up in a Christian home, I always knew the importance biblically and spiritually of God rising from the grave. But ever since 13 years ago, when Phil went on the view of the Lord, it's given me kind of more of a personal reason to look forward to that as well. And to just the realization that because Jesus Christ rose from the dead, because they couldn't keep him down, one day the Bible is going to resurrect us as well. And we're going to have a chance to go to heaven, be resurrected, and see our friends, family members, all the people that are waiting for us up there as well. Some of the other verses here that kind of go along with that, actually, we'll go down to, if you're still there, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4, the last part of the outline for number 3 said, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Okay? So we see, in point number 1, he had to come down. We couldn't get to heaven on our own. He had to come down and make a way for us to get to heaven. Number 2, he couldn't come down. His work on the cross was too important to him and to us to where he would not give in and use the power that he had, that he very easily could have come off the cross. He stayed there for us. And we talk about when he was on the cross, we were on his mind. Number 3, they couldn't keep him down. He rose from the grave no matter what they did. They tried to seal the tomb, they got the rock, they tried to snag him in there, they could not keep him down. And number 4, and this is where the real wonder, what I think, about Easter is he is coming again.
Amen.
He is coming again. 1 Thessalonians 4:14. Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus, God will bring with him. Because he rose from the grave, we have the assurance that when our time on earth is here, when we are buried, that this is not the end of the road for us. Since God conquered the grave, he conquered that not just for himself, but for us as well. We're going to raise too. And if we're saved, we have the opportunity to join him in heaven. John 6:40 says, "And this is the will of him that sent me." This is Jesus talking here. "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in the last day." Okay, we're going to be resurrected from the grave as well. Romans 8:11 says, "But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you," alright, you're saved, you have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, "he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken or make alive your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you." 1 Thessalonians 4:16, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." Okay, so those are all really important verses for us as believers, and we can kind of take comfort and be encouraged to know that this is not the end of the story for us. No matter how long any of us live here on earth, if we live to be 100 years old, this is going to be a drop in the bucket compared to eternity. Now that's great news for us as Christians. But it can be a little bit alarming. That's why I kind of want to challenge you today, if you are not saved, if you're not sure, what would happen to your soul for all of eternity if God were to call it home? You need to get that taken care of today. And what better day, if you've never said to Christ as your Savior, what better day to do it than on Easter Sunday? Which is what a blessing that would be. And some of the verses that go along with that, Daniel 12:2 says, "And many of them asleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt." There is going to be a resurrection of every person in this world who ever lives. The choice is up to us. It could be the everlasting life, to live in heaven with the Lord, or it could be shame and everlasting contempt, and eternity spent out in separation from God Himself, who gave Himself to save you from that very destination. Acts 24:15 says that we have hope toward God, which they themselves also follow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. So everybody who lives, saved and unsaved, we're all going to stand before the Lord one day. And the wonder of Easter is really, if you've been saved and you've accepted Christ as your Savior, you can stand before the Lord with the assurance of knowing that this world is the worst it's ever going to get, that this life is as worst as it's ever going to get. But if you're not saved, you're going to go into the judgment before the sovereign and holy God with the very somber thought that this life is the best it will ever be. You have the opportunity to make that decision today. And I would invite you, if you're even unsure of what the eternal destination is for your soul, if God were to call you home, please, please, get that taken care of today. Get that taken care of today. Let's have every eye bowed. Is there every eye closed and every head bowed, please? There's no looking around now, but just have a show of hands here. If you can think of a time in your life when you can physically, clearly remember, not only accepting Jesus as your Savior, but if you can give a clear testimony, somebody's going to ask you, what's your testimony? How did you get saved? If you've been saved, you could give a testimony of it. Could you just raise your hand up? Okay. If there's anybody here today that if you're not sure, maybe that word being saved or salvation, maybe that's a new word to you, you're not sure what it means. But if you're not sure today, if you were to die, that you would spend eternity in heaven with the Lord. If you couldn't say that you're saved and you know you're going to heaven, if you're not sure, then just lift your hand up. Okay, let's close with a word of prayer real quick. Heavenly Father, just thank you for just such a special day, a wonderful day. And I pray you would just challenge us to never get over the wonder of Easter. The price that you paid for us, the promise that you made to us, the promise that you kept by rising from the grave. We thank you for the assurances that we have here as believers in Christ, that knowing because you defeated death in the grave, because you sent your Son to die on the cross for our sins, through belief in you, we know that we can have the assurance of an eternal home for you in heaven. We thank you for all you do. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Garrett, for the good message this morning. You had to come down. You couldn't come down. They couldn't keep him down. And he is coming again. When we got to that last point, I thought of the hymn, "He is coming again," the chorus. He is coming again, He is coming again, the very same Jesus rejected of men. He is coming again, He is coming again, with power and great glory, He is coming again. If you're excited about the coming of the Lord Jesus again, say amen.
Amen.
take out your bulletin insert again.
Praise the Lord. Is